Hi, shall I start? Okay, yeah. Hi, good afternoon all. Thanks for coming this talk. And myself is Anuj Singla and my friend Akshay Gupta. So we are working in Red Hat as a front-end developer and we are mostly using React and Angular in our projects. So firstly, we will discuss why we are here. So in nowadays, we are using React applications, React framework, Java-based framework, basically Angular, React, Vue, and we are using a lot of JavaScript libraries like Lodash, TypeScript, and many more. So for that, we need we are loading a lot of JavaScript in browser. So if we are loading a lot of JavaScript in browser, definitely it hits the performance. And if it's the performance, then definitely we are losing money for that. Okay, so, and we need to pay for this. So as per the research, if our application, it takes more 1 to 3 seconds, then we lose customers around 21 to 50%. So as per the research by Abandon Group, so this is the desktop for blue one and the mobile for green one. Okay, so if the application takes 1 second, then we lose 6 to 5%. And if takes 2 seconds, then 7 to 14, and 3 seconds, then 21 to 20%. So nowadays we are shifting our application to mobile application. So it's very challenging for the developers to make the website which load within time, like within 1 second. Okay, so there are the three factors which hits the performance. First thing is amount of JavaScript we are loading in the browser in the initial load. The second one is amount of CSS we are downloading in the browser. And the third thing is amount of network request we are making in the initial load. So we can check, there are different tools which we will discuss later, how we can measure how we are loading the data and all things. Okay. So now we have seen there are problems. Now how we will solve these things? So there are different bundling tool, but we will discuss Webpack, but there are like partial rollup. So Webpack is the JavaScript bundling tool which help us to bundle the JavaScript, and it creates the graph dependency as per our configuration. And second one is partial, also the JavaScript bundling tool. And the rollup is also the JavaScript bundling tool. But as per the JavaScript community, there are some code like Webpack we can use for web application, and the rollup we can use for library. But it is not defined, but it's code by the JavaScript community. Okay, so now why Webpack? Why we choose the Webpack? So there are different reasons for this, easy to configure. So Webpack, we can configure very easily. There are file like webpack.config.js. And if we don't provide the entry point, then Webpack is by default take it like source.index.js. Otherwise, we can provide it. And second one is the hot module replacement. It's very important in the development. I will give you one example. Suppose you are debugging some application and you made one change in the file, then it load only that file in the JavaScript, in the browser, not all the application. So it help you to maintain the state of that application because you did not refresh the page. And the async chunk loading and magic comment. So what are chunks? Chunks is the amount of JavaScript or the CSS you are loading in your browser as per your requirement. Okay, and the magic comment like we give the chunk name or prefetching, preloading. We will take it later. And Webpack also take care about performance by default. We just need to define the mode. Either it's a development mode or the production mode. And it also support many assets like font, images, stylesheet. And the next one is it has a good community support. Suppose you want some feature, you can add as a issue. And then there is one website which is by the Webpack votes. So you can give the votes to your feature like you want this feature. The website webpackvotes. Okay. Now how the Webpack works. So firstly, we need to mention the entry point. I have already explained you. So if we don't give in the Webpack 4 version, then it by default takes the src.index. If we mention it, then it will take as per the our configurable. Okay. So entry point is used means Webpack start from the building from that location. And this is the loader send plugin in the Webpack. Okay, first one is the loader will run. Then loader is the transformer which help you to convert, like load the CSS in the browser or convert your TypeScript in the JavaScript. There are different types of loader, like CSS loader, TS loader, Babel loader, and all things. Okay, and the plugins. Plugins are the backbone of the Webpack, and even Webpack is also based on plugins. And there are different types of plugin, like mini CSS plugin, HTML CSS plugin, okay, which help you to convert, or minimize CSS plugins. There are different types of plugin, and in the end, the output. Okay, so it gives you the output as per your configuration. Again, it gives you the one bundle file, all the chunks as per your configuration and all things. Okay, now hand over to me.
Can everyone hear me okay? All right. Okay. Before we actually start investing our time into looking at the solutions of all of these problems, looking into optimization, we need to set a benchmark. We need to measure our performance, which brings me to my next topic, measuring performance. Okay. Now, there are a bunch of matrices that you can use to measure your performance, such as speed indexing and the load time, the time it takes for your website to load and interaction and et cetera, and a plethora of tools such as Lighthouse, Pingdom, and Google Page Speed Insights. So today we are going to talk about Lighthouse. It's an open source project developed by Google, and it measures a bunch of metrics such as performance, page speed, SEO, and accessibility, and et cetera, et cetera. So let's actually look at an example and how to actually use it. Okay, so we're just going to measure the performance of our GitHub website. So to measure the performance, simply go to the website, click right-click. You can either open use Inspect, or you can use one of the other shortcuts, such as Control-Shift-C, to open Chrome Developer Tools. In modern browsers, in latest Google Chrome browsers, Lighthouse is actually shipped with the browser. So you can simply go to Chrome Developer Tools, go on Audits, and there it is, Lighthouse. So as mentioned, it measures a bunch of metrics. You can also choose the device that you're going to use, whether you're developing specifically for desktop or for mobile, and which audit are you going to perform. So we are only choosing performance here. That's because that's the focus of our talk. And you can also throttle your the application based on, let's say, network. So you want to test for a slow 4G network on a smaller device, on a smaller mobile device, or you can choose that as well. So, and just simply click on Run Audits, and Lighthouse will start doing its thing. It majorly takes the performance data from that already existed in the performance tab earlier, and presents it in a meaningful and in a more digestible way. Okay, this might take a minute. Okay, that seems to be our poor performance. I think this is more affected by the Chrome extensions. So I would suggest you do this in you run this in incognito for a better and more accurate data. You can now, Lighthouse gives us a number based out of 100, giving us a performance score of 12, which is very, very low. And it also gives us the matrices I first talked about, such as speed index and first color full paint, and et cetera. What do these actually mean? If you want to go into more details, you can click on this detail button, and you get a little more details of exactly what what Lighthouse is talking about. Lighthouse also gives you exactly what you can do to improve this performance, improve this number. So you have opportunities here. If you were to expand this tab, Lighthouse will tell you exactly which file you can remove or work on. So in this case, GitHub can remove some of the unused CSS to get a better performance score. We will also be talking about one more tool that is Source Map Explorer. I'll be giving a demo for that later on. Okay, so what are the solutions? Now, there are a bunch of solutions. There are a whole lot of solutions that are out there for Webpack optimization. But we chose some of the popular ones, such as code splitting and using Webpack magic commands to prefetch some of the assets, optimizing your code in production, and my personal favorite, shipping ES6 code in production, and pre-shaking. All right. So, code splitting. Modern websites would often combine all of their JavaScript and CSS files into one large bundles. You'll see that some of the time that you'll take all of the CSS and combine into one CSS file or one JS file for all of your JavaScript needs. That results in very, very large files, such as 300 KBs or more than almost an MB sometimes. And browser has to download all of those files, then compile them, and then parse them, and then render them. That takes time, and time is our key for performance. The more time it takes, the worse the user experience becomes. So what is the simplest solution? The simplest solution is to split your code or send only what the browser needs when it needs them. So that brings us to code splitting, which is just basically a simple solution, allows you to split your code into a bunch of smaller file, or as we like to call them, chunks. One of the other reasons you want to split your code is browser caching. It's a little known issue, but browsers usually do is cache your code. So, and if you were to then go change just one word in your entire code, just one line, the bundle will have to be rebuilt again, and the entire bundle has to be downloaded again. But if you were to split your code, then only the part that has changed will have to be downloaded. So a smaller part, let's say, the 10% of what before, 10% of what you downloaded before. So how to actually split your code? We have three main methods: using entry points, using split chunks plugin, and using dynamic imports, which is the most popular one. Let's look at entry points. Entry point is where Webpack looks first to start bundling your code. Usually, as my colleague mentioned, you can provide a simple entry point to your code, and a single bundle will be created. But if you were to provide multiple bundles, multiple entry points, the Webpack will look at those entry points and will create bundles accordingly. Let's actually look at an example. Okay. So first, I'm going to show you one of the basic configs that we did. This is simple as that. We'll be explaining each of these as we go along. Here, we just provided one entry point and one output point. And one of the rules for parsing our JavaScript down to ES5 or more codes, we are using Babel loader. So let me run this and see what happens. I've already set up commands for running everything. So this will just basically run our config file. Okay. And a new folder was created, dist. Let me zoom in a bit. Okay. So zoom in. An index bundle was created, just a single bundle for the entire code. This could be up to 400 KBs or more. As Webpack reminds us that this is 362 KBs, which is much more than what the size limit that we have, 244 KBs. Okay. As you might notice, there is one more file called .map. This is called a source map. Source maps are basically used to map your bundled and minified code back to the way it was, the original way. And you can use it to see exactly what's inside your code after bundling it. So how do we do that? We have a tool called Source Map Explorer. Let me run this. Source Map Explorer. You just provide it where your JavaScript files are. So inside the distribution folder, start.js, simply press enter, and voila. Source Map Explorer gave you a simple HTML file and tell you that exactly what was inside the folder. We'll be using this going ahead to show you what's inside the code. So that brings us to entry points. We have created multiple branches so that the one of our codes does not affect the others, as we have a lot to present. Okay, let me go to my branch. Code splitting. Inside, you'll find a folder, code splitting, webpack config, and the entry point. The only change between this entry point config and webpack config is just that there is now a second entry. So what will webpack do? Let's run this and see. You can find all of these commands that I'm running in package.json. Okay, Webpack has something for us. And as we can see, two different files were created compared to the last time. It's an index.js and there is an app.js. The same goes for CSS. Our CSS was also split between these two files. I'm gonna see what's inside them. Using Source Map Explorer, we have now two different files. Okay, all right. Combined, they represent 4 to 528 KBs. And that brings me to the problem of this approach, duplication. If you notice, libraries such as yup, lodash, formic are duplicated between the index bundle and the app bundle. You can see formic here and here. Same goes for lodash here. So that is the first problem. That is the first problem with the solution. The second problem is flexibility and scalability. As your application grows, it will be difficult to keep track of all of the entry points that we have created and loading them accordingly. So Webpack has a solution for us in the forms of split chunks plugin. This plugin allows you to move certain parts of your application into different bundles. So if you have a dependency such as Lodash or Formic, and you've used that multiple times, you can extract it and take it into a single separate file. How does that work? Okay, simply go to your Webpack config. We have removed the entry point now. And we've added this piece of code, optimization split chunks all. Let me show you what it does. Okay, so we have something. This time there were two files created, but the difference is that we have an index.js file and a vendor's index.js file. So by default, what Webpack did, it took all of those vendor files and put them inside the vendor's index.js file. So if you were to have more entry points or more files, they would simply be split into two. Let me show you the source map. Okay. The vendor's index file only contains dependency and not the code we have written. However, the index files contains the code that we have written, the small to-do app. You can also customize the split chunks plugin to a very fine degree, such as you can do this by cache groups. So simply write cache groups, the name of the bundles that you want, and vendors. You can provide it a test attribute which represents what you actually want to split. So if I were to write node modules, the Webpack config will create a new vendor file as it did, which is what it did by default, and take all of the node modules and put them inside a single file. You can also do this for, let's say, have a bunch of utilities. You can create a new vendor, new cache group util test, and simply provide it the path, and the bundles will be split. Okay. There are a lot more options and a lot more finer control that you can go on and find them on Webpack's website. But I'm not gonna go them into here, so. Okay. Now, the final and third point is dynamic imports. JavaScript provides us with an import syntax that you can use to load modules on demand when exactly when you need them. This is the most popular method for code splitting. So let me go to my branch, code splitting import. And this time, the import config had very little difference. If you were to just take the basic config, that would work. The difference is in our Babel RC file, for we have to tell Babel to expect syntax called import, the import syntax. So what did we actually change? How do we actually use it? So we come to our app.jsx files, and we have split our app based on the routes we're using. I'm going to explain that in a minute. So we're importing our, by using the import function syntax, we can import the files as and when we need them. Let me show you that. Okay, I have to install the plugin that I just used. I will put all of that information in package.json, so just to save time and build it. Okay, let me serve this. I'm gonna serve this with a simple HTTP server. So this is our simple app. At this point, three files were fetched, index 1 and 3. Now if I were to log in and go here, click on submit, as you see, I went to a separate route and a new JS file was fetched on demand. That is the benefit of using code splitting. Okay. So we started with a monolithic bunch, and we split that code into smaller and smaller chunks as we went along.
Okay, thank you, Akshay. So so my friend Akshay has explained what are the code splitting, how we can do code splitting in a different way. He has explained like dynamic code splitting or entry point code splitting. Okay, so now if you see, we are giving the index name to the chunks like 1, 2, 3, but we don't know which chunks are loading. So we can give the valuable name to that chunk, or we can also tell the Webpack when we need to load that chunk, like with the help of prefetch or post or the preload. So I will explain you with the help of example. Okay, so for that, I have created the branch for this, and I'm just building the code. So I'm just building the code, and it will create the disk folder. And if you see here in this, it's built, it's the name of the chunk is 1, 2, 3, 4, but we don't know what are the name of the chunk. So, okay, so we can give the name with the help of magic comments. Okay, so I'm just giving the magic comment name. Okay, so this is the import way for creating the chunk, and this is the way which is provided by the Webpack. So what is the name of this one? Webpack chunk name is like login button. This is the login form. We can give any name. Okay, it's a text string, and or how it will load the Webpack prefetch or the preload. Okay, so we can give any like true or false to that, and we can give the same thing to all the imports. OK, now see the. OK, now if you see, it gives the proper name, which chunks is this, like footer, or the login form, or the to-do app. OK, and the one thing is, we can make the chunks to the by default, default components. But we can also give, if the component is not default, like import default, then we can give like this. The syntax of this means we can treat like this. Default is module.todoApp. If the component is not by default importing. I will explain like if you see this, this is the, this export module is export default, and the module name is valid login form, OK? And if you see this, if you see the to-do app, this is only the export, not the default. So how the syntax for this is? Like import dot then module, and the name module dot to-do app, the name, and the default. Means we treat like it's a default module. Yeah, and the second one thing is, what is the difference between prefetch and preload? So prefetch means it load the chunk when the browser is idle, and the preload means it load the chunk with the main bundle. Okay, it's load parallelly with the main bundle, and when we will use the preload and the prefetch, suppose there is one button on the page, okay? So the model will open on click of that. So for that, you can use the prefetch because we need this chunk in the future. And the second example of preload, you can use, suppose there are two buttons you need to show, the login or the sign up. So for that, you can use with the help of in the main page. Home page, so you use parallelly the login sign up button and for the means login button form. Now next one is the production optimization. So we have seen how we can make the chunk and all things. Now the next one is the production optimization. So we need to make our bundle optimized. Like in the development mode, we use the commands, spaces in our code, but we don't need this in the production. There is no use, okay? So there are different way we can do to remove these things, okay? So Webpack provide, we have already explained the mode. So there are two things, either you can give the production mode or the development mode, okay? So Webpack by default perform some operations like minify your code and all things. And the second one is the mini CSS extract plugin. This is also useful to extract the CSS from the different JavaScript, or it depend on the configuration, either you want different CSS file or the one CSS file. And the third one is very useful is optimize CSS asset plugin. So it help you to optimize the CSS. For example, you have used four classes of CSS, but you are using only two. So it removed that extra two classes because you are not using that. And next one is the, if you want to extract all CSS in one file, you can use cache grouped optimization. And next one is the tree shaking. So tree shaking means remove the dead code from your application. We will see it how we will do this. Yeah, so this is the way you can use the plugin like optimize CSS asset plugin, the first one I explain you. And the second one is if you want to extract all CSS in one file, this is the optimization cache style. And the third one is like if it's a production environment, and then you can use the mini CSS extract plugin. And if it's the normal, like development mode, then you use the style loader, CSS loader, because for that we are debugging our code. Okay, so let's see with the help of example. Okay, so if you see here, we are not creating any CSS file, and it's all included in the bundle file. Okay, so now how we will extract this? So I have used different plugins, which I have explained you. So in my script, I am providing the environment.modis production. Okay, so I'm doing the production environment. So now just building our code. I need to install it. Yeah, if you see here, it extract all the CSS in one file, style.css, but it is not minified. Okay, so how we can minify this? There is another one plugin. Optimize CSS asset. Now if you see, it's minifies all the CSS and all things.
Okay, so this brings us to my favorite point, shipping ES6 code, ES6 plus code in production. So, JavaScript every year brings out the ECMA script standard, which introduces newer and newer feature every year, such as async await, classes, fetch, and et cetera. But we still transpile down our code down to ES5, the oldest standard, and we add polyfills to account for these features in some of our legacy browsers. We took a look at our analytics data and see what browsers the users were using. And it turns out that 95% of our users were using modern browsers, the latest ones, evergreen browsers such as Google Chrome, Mozilla Firefox, and et cetera. So what we were essentially doing is shipping unused code to production. So how do we solve this issue? We can simply create two different build or multiple different builds for depending on the browser we use. We can remove transpilation and selectively add the polyfills that we need at runtime. I've been talking a lot about modern browsers, so let me define what I actually mean. We've selected these four browsers, anything Chrome above 61 and Safari above 11 and above. So we've selected this data based on caniuse.com. And that basically tells you which browsers support which features. Most of these browsers support all of the modern ES6 plus features, so you don't have to transpile down your code for these browsers. So, how do we actually do it? Using script type modules. So, the script tag has a new attribute called type equals to modules, and it basically will tell the browser to load JavaScript as modules, and browsers that usually support this feature, type equals to module, also support ES6 features. So if you were to create two bundle files and add those tags, such as these one, in your index.html, the modern browsers will look at this type of modules and download this modern MJS files, module files. But and the older legacy browsers will ignore this and only download the no module files. Let's look at an example on how to generate two different Webpack builds. Okay. Okay. So we added a new folder in our Webpack config. One Webpack config for EF5 files and one for ES6 files. What's the difference? we use a plugin called Babel Preset Environments. What it does is allows you to create your code according to a browser environment. So in ESI5, we provided that you create a build for or transpile our JavaScript for these browsers, for Firefox, extended support, the last two versions of the browsers, and et cetera. The same thing we did with the ES5, ES6 config. And there we provided the modern browsers list. So the Babel preset environment will not transpile down your code and actually look at these browsers and what features they support and see what it will transpile or not transpile. So, okay, let's actually run this and see what happens. I forgot to npm install again. Sorry. Okay. This might take more than a minute, so I'm gonna go ahead and look at some of the other things. Okay. So what happened in our distribution folder, we created two different builds, one for legacy and one for modern. And let's look at the index.html. And a script type equals to modules were added for the modern build. How did we do this? We used something called the script ext.html webpack plugin. It basically will modify the script tag and add the type equals to module if you were to provide this particular property, module as MJS. Okay, so what did we actually benefit? Let me run this. Okay, first I wanna talk about the pitfalls of this method. Using the type equals to module attribute will work in almost every browser except for IE, Edge, and Safari 10. The issue is that IE, Edge, and Safari 10 will download the module MJS files, but they will not execute them. So they will not ignore the script type equals to module file. And Edge is even worse. It will download both of these files, but only execute the legacy files. So how do we solve this problem? We can selectively serve the modern or the legacy bundle based on the browser's user agent. So how do we do that? We created our own simple express server. Some of you might have seen this. Any request that comes in gets checked its browser agent against our modern list. So if it is modern, then serve the modern files. If it is not, serve the legacy files. Let's look at this in action. So I'm just gonna run the server file. Okay, our React app. As you can see, our React app is now serving .mjs files. It's 84.3 KB. And so I'm gonna switch the user agent using a Chrome extension to IE10, and the browser now switched to .js files. So you can selectively serve which bundle you want exactly to which browser. There's one thing to keep in mind. You have to make sure that the MIME type of .js and .cs files is exactly correct. Otherwise, the browser will simply not execute the MJS files. Okay. The second is selectively adding polyfills. We add a number of polyfills for our ES6 features, such as async await classes, and for our web platform features, such as fetch and promises. So what you can do is add those polyfills at runtime, depending on the browsers. Now, a service like polyfill.io exists for this very purpose, but it has a pitfall that it runs at runtime, mainly blocking the rendering thread, and you are also depending on a third-party services. So if a polyfill does not exist on polyfill.io, you simply cannot use this. So ES6 polyfill, you if you were to provide Babel preset environments and use the property use built-in entry, what it will do, it will take what is generally used for polyfills, import Babel polyfill, figure out the environment, and serve only the polyfills that that the browser needs. Also, to selectively serve the web platform features such as fetch, we created two different index entries. So index.es5.js, it will contain the ES5 polyfills, and index.es6.js, that only contains all of the stuff that some of the modern browsers need, such as intersection observer. So you can build this by simply changing. Okay, two builds were created. So looking at the source map of both of these files, this is the legacy file that it contained 416 KBs, and the modern file which contains a smaller build, 387. It may not seem much of a difference right now, but as your application grows, this becomes much, much more useful. I'm gonna hand it over to my colleague, Anuj, for the pre-shaking part.
Okay, yeah, thank you. So now next topic is tree shaking. Tree shaking means remove the unused code which we are not using in our application. So for example, we have used one helper file, okay, which has two method, and we are only using one method. So if we are loading the another method in the production, then there is no use for that, and it increases the bundle size. So the tree shaking help us to remove that one function from your application, from your bundle. So Webpack is already providing by default. Just we need to inform the Webpack, you can do the tree shaking for us. Like there is one property in the packet.json we need to provide, side effect, and you just need to give the false. And then it will do all the things for you. So we will take with the help of fix example. So okay, so I have created one utility class and which has square and cube method. Okay, and in the index app.js, I'm just using the square method, only one method. Okay, so now we will check how it's work. Firstly, I will mention the you should not minimize that code because I want to see how the Webpack will work. Okay, we will see now the bundle file. If you see the bundle file and just search for that function, like I have used the console.log for easily find. And if you see here, the Webpack is added, like there one comment is unused harmony export is cube because we are not using that method. Okay, so now, and we have also mentioned to the side effect is false to the Webpack, you can do the tree shaking for us. And now I will do the development mode, then production mode. Save that, and the minify should be true. Just build the code. Now, if you see here, there is only one square method is used. The second one is removed from our final bundle file. OK. So now we have sort of time, just final thoughts and then question.
OK, so there is a ton more that we wanted to cover, such as especially compression. You can use gzip compression or Brotli compression, which is something new, to compress down your files and exactly serve smaller and smaller files. There is also, yes, for in shipping ESX Plus code, you can also remove some of the CSS prefixes from using auto prefixer plugin to remove some of the CSS prefixes for the modern browsers that don't need them. Yes. Questions?
So one more thing, Webpack is a very big topic. You can check on YouTube and all things. And there are very good good documentation on the Webpack site. You can just check and all things. There is one tutorial on front-end master website. So you can, this tutorial is created by the founder of the Webpack. Yeah, so okay. That's it. Any question?
Yes. What was a Lighthouse code? Yes. Actually, I'm sorry. So what was the Lighthouse code after we did the Webpack optimization? OK. So and we did have an example that we wanted to present, but due to certain internet issues that we had to remove some of those code. But we experienced almost a 40% increase in our Lighthouse code. I remember it was 52, and we were at 83 or 84 or something after our optimization. So yes, there is a lot you can do with this. And compression is the best ones, the single biggest improvement you can do. Most servers that will serve your files, such as Apache or Nginx, will have gzip compression by default enabled, specifically designed for browsers. There is also a new one called Brotli that you can use.
And we are also checking how much code we are shipping in the initial load. There is one code coverage in the dev tool you can check and just optimize that code. And the second one is there are backend API, means we are getting the network calls. You can figure out how many network calls we are making. So if that network, if you are not use of that network call in the initial load, you will do after 5 seconds. Like we are doing. Suppose we need the five call in the first second, and then the another 10 after 5 seconds. So we have added in the set timeout and just call after 5 seconds, so that the browser will load the JavaScript and all things. We are doing these types of tricks also.
Anyone else?
Any question?
Anyone
if
else?
Do you have any? Yeah.
Yes. Yes. So the tree shaking is much more granular. It actually looks into each function of your code. So there are no plugins that I'm aware of or tools that I'm aware of that can tell you exactly what tree shaking is using. But you can still use Lighthouse, and that will tell you exactly that you can remove unused code on unused code that is loaded here right now. Or there is also for CSS there is dead code elimination plugins that available, but for JavaScript I'm not aware if there are any tools available. Anyone else? Anything else, everyone? All right.
Thank you. All right. Thanks all for your valuable time. Thanks for coming.